Okay, so as we learned, the periodic trend of ionization energy can roughly be predicted based on an element's position in the periodic table. We learned that in the lower left-hand corner, the ionization energies are really small because the electrons are furthest away from the nucleus, right? They're in really large shell numbers, and the atomic number on the left side is the smallest. If we're thinking about a given row or a given shell. And in the top right corner, we're now in a really small shell, and within that shell, we have a maximum atomic number. So here we have really large ionization energies. So our general trend moves from the bottom left to the top right. The further right and the further up an atom is on the periodic table, the larger the ionization energy we would predict is. Okay? So let's actually look at a plot of ionization energies for the first looks like this is the first 11 elements. Okay? What we note here is that going from hydrogen to helium, right? So going from hydrogen to helium here, right, where within the first row, the first shell, and we are increasing the ionization energy, which can be explained purely based on an increase in the atomic number. We then drop down to lithium, which isn't predicted based on the increase in atomic number, but in the periodic table, lithium is now in shell number 2, whereas hydrogen and helium are in shell number 1. So we could predict that lithium should have a lower ionization energy because the valence electron for lithium is further away from the nucleus than the valence electron in helium. Okay, still within the second shell, we move to beryllium. And beryllium has a larger ionization energy, which is expected because lithium has an atomic number of 3, whereas beryllium has an atomic number of 4. So more protons mean that the ionization energy should be larger because the potential energy is more negative. But note here, going from beryllium to boron, we actually go downhill. The ionization energy decreases going from beryllium to boron. And that's unexpected. We're still in the second shell, and boron has 5 protons, whereas beryllium has 4. So there must be something else happening here that makes boron have a lower ionization energy, easier to remove an electron than beryllium. Okay? We see this same deviation from our expected trend going from nitrogen to oxygen. We see a downhill trend within the same shell, even though the general trend, Coulomb's law, predicts that we should be increasing the ionization energy. So in both cases here, we can explain this exception based on the stability of electron configurations. All right, let's think about ionizing beryllium. Okay, so beryllium has an electron configuration of 1s2, 2s2, and if we ionize beryllium, we remove an electron, we go to 1s2, 2s1. Okay, what I'd like you to note here is that beryllium, before ionized, has a full subshell, so the 2s subshell. But once we've removed an electron, we've lost that full subshell, so we no longer have a full subshell, meaning that this electron configuration is less stable than this electron configuration. Let's compare that to boron. So boron has 5 electrons, 1s2, 2s2, 2p1. And when we remove an electron, we remove the first electron here, the highest energy electron, this becomes 1s2, 2s2. Now, in this case, we've actually created a stable electron configuration, right? We've created a full subshell, and boron started with an unstable configuration. So, with beryllium, we destroy a favorable electron configuration, a stable one, And with boron, we produce one. So that's the reason why beryllium has a higher ionization energy than boron, because the outermost electron in beryllium is making that electron configuration stable. Whereas with boron, we have 2p1. If we remove this, we end up with a more stable electron configuration. So removing an electron from boron creates a stable situation, whereas removing an electron from beryllium destroys a stable situation. Let's see if we can make the same argument going from nitrogen to oxygen. Okay, so nitrogen has 7 valence electrons. So we have 1s2, 2s2, 2p3, right? So p3, so our 2p3 here, we have 3 orbitals. So 1, 2, 3. And remember when we said when we have a half full subshell, this is stable. So nitrogen is starting stable. And when we remove an electron, we have 1s2, 2s2, 2p2. So we've actually removed an electron, destroying our stable electron configuration. With oxygen, we start 1s2, 2s2, 2p4. So with oxygen here, our 2p, we have our 3 orbitals, we have 1 electron, 2, 3, 4. When we remove an electron from this, we end up with 1s2, 2s2, 2p3. So with oxygen, we've actually created a stable situation once we remove one electron. Okay? So when the trend deviates from the expected observation from Coulomb's law, we can always explain this based on considering the production, right? So producing stable configurations or destroying them.